back in Chicago. We take a look at our updated Universal Open Rocket League Midwest Regional Bracket presented by American Sail. But first, we want to let you guys know that we already have a bunch of the teams that are headed to the Grand Finals in Santa Ana. As you can see right here, Genesis, Itzlit, Wabi Sabi, Incognito, all qualifying from the U.S. Open Regional. Of course, in Philadelphia, we saw G2A and G2B both qualify. And then two teams coming from the Northeast Regional will be joined by the four teams actually coming out of Europe today. So many more teams to go through, and I hope you guys will join us for today's action and tomorrow's Western Regional in San Francisco. These are our brackets presented by American Sail. Right now, though, in the semifinals, we're about to kick things off with DAPG versus Enix. Then, of course, we're going to have Splice versus Runaway right afterwards to see who will qualify for the Grand Finals in Santa Ana for their shot at $100,000 in the Universal Open for Rocket League. We are back, though, and it's time to jump into our first semifinal. As we mentioned before, we have DAPG versus Enix coming up next here. Now, we joked a little bit before that the quarterfinal would be to see who is going to lose to DAPG. Enix didn't take too kindly to that. They got a real shot here?
I get either way here. I get to have something cool. I either get an amazing upset over DAPG, or I get to be right. So, you know.
Okay, fair enough. Quinn, what do you got, man?
Playing the probability game, huh, Wavepunk?
Yeah, sure.
I think that we're going to see DAPG here come on so strong. I mean, such a great team here. You can see it in front of you right now. Dapper playing for Renegades and Garrett G for Energy Esports. These guys are staples of the 3v3 scene, some of the best players in the world.
Yeah, that's absolutely right. So we're going to get to know Dapper a little bit here as well. As we mentioned, he plays for the Renegades, third place at the X Games Rocket League Invitational in Minneapolis just recently last month. So looking forward to seeing a little bit more about this guy. Take a look.
My name is Chris Mendoza. I go by Dapper. I'm 18 years old from Ontario, California. I've played Rocket League since the game came out in July of 2015. I've probably played more than 3,500 hours in the game. My favorite food is spaghetti. My favorite athlete is Kobe Bryant. My favorite thing to do outside of gaming is photography and filming. If I won the grand prize, the first thing I would buy is a gift for my mom.
You know what? At least that's the best one we've heard so far. We've heard they're going to save it, they're going to stash it aside, pay off a car or whatever. He's giving a gift
to his
mom.
That's your favorite responsible answer.
What's up?
That's your favorite responsible answer?
Yes, it is, of course. It has to be. He's giving a gift to his mom.
I thought it was going to be the spaghetti.
Oh. Well, okay. So Dapper was interesting just because you're so young, you're competing at a high level here, and he's got some idols, like he said, in Kobe Bryant, things like that, people that are longtime athletes. So I want to see how he actually models his play. And we're going to take a look at Enix as well. Of course, they are the other team that is competing in this semifinal. Of course, as we mentioned before, the winner of this set is going to advance into the grand finals at Santa Ana. They won't be done for today, though. They're going to have to come back for the finals today to determine seeding and see who actually gets that number one seed out of the Midwestern Regional here. As you can see, Sham playing for Enix. He is from South Carolina, previously playing for Soar Gaming. His teammate, Schwind, also previously played for Soar Gaming. Like I said, got a little bit of my heart in this one because he's the only other 30-year-old that I've seen, you know, that's even associated with Rocket League. So do we just like, is it like Sparta? You just get like pushed off a cliff or something like that at 29 and you're not allowed in Rocket League anymore? Like, why aren't we in here?
I mean, with esports in general, there's very few professional players I can think of that are over the age of 30. It's just such a youth-dominated scene in every way, shape, and form.
Yeah, I mean, I agree totally. I'm a former player. I retired at 24.
Yep.
So, I mean, I can't break the stereotype. I'm sorry, guys.
Fair enough. That's okay. I'll just be the old guy for a little while. Anyway, well, the game's going to get started here momentarily. Based on what you saw from DAPG in game number one when we found that they were a little bit colder and stuff like that, what are you looking for them in the first couple of minutes to hear to see if they've changed that, if they're going to be a little less cold?
I mean, looking for the passing plays, see if they can pull it off. And honestly, I think that if we're talking about the team that has the best chance to upset, I think Enix has got, of all the teams left in the tournament, between them facing off against DAPG and Runaway facing off against Splice, they honestly probably have the best opportunity here. We'll see if they can do it, but immediately, we talked about wanting to see the passes from DAPG. They're already guns ablazing in the enemy territory.
Right, and let's not disrespect this Enix team too much.
No.
We talked about how there's a big chance of an upset, and Wavepunk, you mentioned specifically how they're ready to lose to DAPG. But a big part of these bubble players, as we describe them, they usually seem to rise up to against their opponents. So when they're playing against better teams, yep, they will perform better themselves, kind of taking the pressure in stride.
Well, we'll have to see that from Runaway later, but we'll talk about that when we get there. Right now, Enix gonna try and take it against DapG, and this one going the distance. Can Dapper get there in time? He should be able to clear this one away to the side. If the breakaway had a bit more pace on it, that would have been the first goal going to Enix.
I think Dapper actually trying to bait in the other team there to try and make a shot, and Dapper was trying to bait him in.
Didn't quite work out for him at this point, but they do have ball control in enemy territory. 3:50 left to go. The first minute came and went quietly. Garagy shoot towards the net. Sham blocks it away. Now gets it over the top of Dapper. It's just Garagy in the back. He punts high. Let's Dapper rotate around. Dapper will rotate into the one position. Now Garagy moving up. Only one player in the back here. Sham going to try and buy time. Wrap it around the corner, but what a demolition. Dapper, realizing immediately he had lost, focused on the ball, immediately hones in on the goalie, and it's just up to Garagy to do the rest.
Right. Once Garagy takes this ball up the field, off that 50-50, Dapper goes right away for that demo, and it's huge. I mean, being able to recognize that your teammate has time to touch the ball and that he's going to take that time, mm-hmm, is what is the biggest difference between these top-level teams and the bubble teams, as we describe them.
Yeah, and the more time you give these pro players to take the shot, the more accurate and more difficult to block it's going to be. What a fall there, and Dapper gets it away just in time. The shot was quite close. Dapper moves up the field, tries to pass out to Garagy, but Sham there waiting it out. Second touch goes in Garagy's favor, and Dapper rotates around. The pass comes across, but a bit farther than Dapper was ready for. It's probably expected to come out a bit. Now it's Sham with Geschwind very close in support. Down the field, Geschwind flips in front of his net. He'll clear it a bit to the side, but Dapper will be able to pass it right back into the box. Garagy to try and kill it in the midfield.
And actually just great control there from Garagy. You see he gets the bounce and purposefully turns on that bounce to get extra power. I mean, this guy knows exactly what touch he wants to do. I mean, it's unbelievable to watch.
2:28 left to go. Geschwind down the field. Garagy now airborne, taking a shot towards the net. Sham blocks it away. And Dapper trying to position for the rebound. He'll just kill in the midfield, leaving for Garagy. 1v1 now, 1v2 as Dapper moves upfield as well. So many options here, and Geschwind blocks Garagy's shot. It's back in the middle. If Dapper turns in time, he could take the shot here, but Sham comes from the side, clears it away, and they'll dodge another bullet. They're still down by one, but they are holding on to this score margin.
Right, and I mentioned earlier, living up against their opponents, right? As the games get more difficult, as their opponents get more skilled, they seem to level up, if you will, themselves. And we've seen that here from them, and keeping a one-goal scoreline against a team like DapG is not easy.
Sham moving this one up the field. They might be able to tie it up here, but Geschwind misses the touch, and Garagy will send it away. Geschwind gets a demolition on a Dapper, so it's just Garrett in net here. He misses the second touch, and Dapper nearly gets back in time, but no good. We got a tie game.
Right, a great pass here from Sham. He, after the demo, puts it above Garagy, and Garrett just goes for the hard read right away, recognizing that Dapper won't be able to get back in goal in time. And unfortunately, the pass was just too good.
1:29 left to go here in game number one. Now in the quarter, and now in the semifinals, these are best of five. So we have moved up. You have to win three, not just two. And a win in this series moves you into the finals, and it qualifies you for Santa Ana for the grand finals of the Universal Open. So a lot on the line here in these five games. Sham gets it past one, up to Garagy. Can he get the redirect towards the net? Soft. But Geschwind clears it away. And now Sham passed Garagy. It's Dapper in the back. Moves up to challenge. Gets it past one. Can he get it past two? You were mentioning it earlier, Dapper, one of the best 1v1 players from North America. We talk about 3v3 a lot. The 1v1 scene, Dapper, very well respected. And now Garagy to try and pass this one off.
And I think Garagy tries to play to that strength of Dapper. You see him, he's positionally very strong and has great anticipation. He just waits for Dapper to go for these dribbles and let him dictate the play, and Garagy kind of supplementing a support player, if you will.
Yeah. Some excellent, beautiful spider defense from Dapper there. It's a few shots, a few soft shots on net for Meenix. Garagy needs to get in there. He'll play that one away. Now a shot downfield. Dapper to move it around. And as the clock counts down, it's looking like we're probably going to have overtime here in game number one with Enix versus Dap G. Garrett might try to keep this one alive. He does. Takes a shot downfield. Dapper's up. Take one last-ditch effort. He's going to drop in front of Garrett. He could take the shot. Oh, but it won't make the distance. It'll touch the ground, and we'll go to overtime in game one.
On the goal line. Those guys so calculated, able to keep the ball up. And what a great shot. Unfortunately, it wasn't enough for these guys.
Oh, Sham and Gishwin with an opportunity to transition this downfield quickly. The shot is high. Some inaccuracy plaguing Enix right now, and Dapper will be able to outplay Sham, get the victory here. And it was the 1v1 skills of Dapper that came to play.
This guy's ice cold. Just so many mind games going on between them. And that's the patience I talk about when you see these top-level teams, and specifically Dapper. He will always opt for this mind game. And sometimes it can throw you off just to directly challenge him. Unfortunately, that challenge missed the ball. And we see Dapper, I mean, just cruising on through game number one. Just great play.
I got to say, I really feel like Enix right now if they had been able to put more of these goals in, this would be a completely different game. They had so many opportunities where they had really broken down the defense of Dap G and then were not able to score. But on the other side of things, Dap G on fire here, putting in the goals they needed. 11 shots, only two of them go in, but it was only two that they needed.
They certainly never played afraid, though. They had that confidence we saw from the interview. They weren't giving any cheap opportunities. They were playing solid defense. They had a lot of competent saves. So it certainly looked like these guys brought their A game, though. I would expect that each of these games are going to be this competitive.
Right, I would agree. I think that Enix is going to feel better going into this game, knowing that they have had opportunities. They missed them, but I think Enix is at a level where they can say, you know what, that was game number one. Game number two is going to be a different story.
All right, fair enough. Well, we're going to jump into game number two. What do they got to do? Put on more pressure? Do they got to force Dap G to make more mistakes at this point? Play their branded game? What do you think?
Honestly, I don't think they need to do that much differently. They were pretty successful relatively, and there were a few opportunities from them that were great. It's just that their last touch, the shots, execution wasn't quite there yet. Game number two, there's a different opportunity, a different story, and a great chance for them to be able to make that.
Which, and while you are suffering from inaccuracy, the option is to get more pressure, to just be able to put the ball in the mid territory, give yourself more opportunities. They had about half the shots that we saw from Dap G, so if they're able to take more shots, they'll be able to deal with being a bit more inaccurate and make a game out of it. Only a one-goal game there in game number one as it went to overtime. Sham going to take a shot here early in game two. And remember, best of five. Again, they could afford to make a few mistakes and then come back into it. A win here would even up the series. Give us a ball game here in the semifinals in Chicago. Garagy out to Dapper. He'll dribble that one past one. And now he's just going to get, can he get it past Sham here? We'll tackle it to the side. Dapper on the wall looks to possibly win the 50-50 with Gishwin, but does not find contact. Garagy will move it down the field. You're going to see him moving it up. Went over to the side as Sham moves into net. Garrett now back towards the net. Sham will clear it away. Well placed shot by Garrett, but not enough speed on it to get it past Sham. Now over to the side. Garagy with the dribble plays into the enemy territory. Dapper in support. Sham in the net. And won't be able to get it through Sham. Moves up to block the passing lane, transition onto offense. Dapper has to carry this one away. Gets a pass to Schwinn. Sham is moving back as well. Dapper, can he get the dribble plays here? He's done it before. Cannot get it past Sham this time. But Garagy looking to try and drop it in off the backboard. Does not find anything. Dapper needs to play interference. He's up too far. Sham will put it in, and Enix scores the first goal.
Dapper here, I don't want to say this is complacency. I think he just didn't recognize the speed at which Sham was ready to go for this ball. He goes up right away, and Dapper, when you play that far up, he needs to go up to contest immediately. Ideally, you'd be facing forward. Since Dapper's backwards, he just can't take the time. He needs to go up and make sure he wins that aerial.
And Enix now with the lead in game number two. Looking to tie up the series at a game apiece. Gishwin now setting this one back into the box. Keeping it there, but Garrett will pick this one up onto his hood. Has Dapper up as a linebacker, just messing with Sham in his own half. Nothing really happens of it. I'm not sure if Garagy really made a clean shot there.
I don't think Garagy had boost there. You see him, he right away goes to the flick and tries to turn to go for Boost. I think he's trying to get the ball to Dapper, but we saw great defense from Enix just covering Dapper, closing off that opportunity.
Oh my goodness, can he get it through? Garrett, if he just turns, he's expecting it to roll all the way to the side. And instead, it goes back into the middle there. But Dapper, smooth plays to get it past the first. Garrett G now to take a shot. Can he double tap this one down? Oh, it bounces off the crossbar. Couldn't quite sneak it underneath. And Sham will keep their one goal lead.
And you've seen Garrett G hit these shots so many times. You know that he's eating at himself inside for not being able to even up the scoreline there.
Garrett G coming in from the side. And win this one around. Dapper, seeing Sham would make the clear, falls back. But now back up to play. Waiting for the spider touch to give it to him. He'll play it up into the corner. Now he's drawn both defenders in, but Kachwin gets it away. Garrett G gets demoed in the midfield. Dapper has to move up and contest because Garrett G's going to spawn behind him. Now these plays, Garrett G onto the backboard. Does that drop in? No, Sham plays it to the side. What a save. Brilliant read from the Enix player.
Seriously, just an incredible save to be able to get that. It looked like that was dropping right in underneath the crossbar.
Schwinn puts it in the middle. I think he was expecting Sham to be there, but he just concedes ball control over to Garrett G. Dapper in the middle. Pick up Boost. Turn this one around. Beautiful plays there. Just has to get this touch into the net. It goes off the post, but Garrett G's there to finish it off. Shut down the clear option, and we got a tie game here in game two.
Look at how fast Dapper makes that turn. He sees both players there pressuring the ball and in possession, and he doesn't care. He knows the distance and timing that he needs as a 1v1 player, especially to be able to make that turnaround, to be able to make that interception, and be able to sneak in a goal underneath their nose.
All tied up in one apiece with 1:28 left to go in game two. Enix still looking to tie up the series. A great play in front of the net. Garrett G will shut it down and now try to move this one back out. Going for the solo carries by himself. Put it onto the backboard, out to Dapper. The shot towards the net is wide. And now Sham has the breakaway opportunity. Can he get it all the way down? Yep, that one's home free. In it goes, and Enix takes the lead right back.
And Sham with the turtle goal showing off a little bit. He doesn't need his wheels to score. But that was a huge just blunder there from Dapper to shoot onto the side of the post. He didn't even hit the post, unfortunately, which makes me think it was just like a little bit of a mistiming type of error, just not turning properly. And unfortunately for them, that's what leads to a quick goal. They have 1 minute left.
Garrett G on the wall to play this one away. As you said, only 1 minute remaining. They're down by one. A loss here in game two would tie up the series at a game apiece. Garrett G taking it slow, past Geschwind, and past Sham. Shot on net goes wide. Dapper plays it past one more, again a shot towards net, again, and Sham with the save.
And what I think there is bad decision making from Dapper, a little selfish perhaps. He could have opted to put that ball to the side to Dapper, who was lurking in the middle. And these are the team plays I think we need to be able to see if they want to be able to make a comeback in 25 seconds.
They only are down by one. They can play into 0 second time. Right now, just struggling to get it past the wall of Sham on defense. Garrett G with another opportunity to double tap this one down. It will go through. The World Star player ties up the game with only 15 seconds remaining.
You said it, world class. I mentioned earlier, he's so good at this. He knows exactly how he needs to position his car. And if you wait, he paints. It's just, it puts on a clinic when it comes to double touches. He's so patient, going up into the air, giving the ball time to travel away from the wall, opening up his angle of approach to the goal. It's just so well done there from Garrett G.
And now with 10 seconds left, Sham gonna try and see if he can put it away in regulation, but Dapper tackles him, forces him to lose ball control. This is still a juicy opportunity for Geschwind, who sends it to the net, a backflip from Garrett, 1 second remaining, but this game's basically over, as Dap G's gonna concede one here.
Right, a great challenge there from Sham, puts it off the ramp and back into the center of field. And Geschwind with the 1 second left goal, the buzzer beater. We see a backup there from Garrett. I mean, did the world align or what?
It will align for Enix here as they take game number two. And Quinn, we got a series on our hands. Everybody expecting the sweeps from Dap G here. They have yet to sweep anybody. Dropping
Look who's
a game.
Talking.
Well, they dropped a game in the quarterfinals, and now they have dropped game two here in the semifinals. Anything can happen here in Chicago. This is crazy.
I mean, let's take a look here at the control there from Dapper. That's just more of his dribbling that we've seen time and time again. He just moves his car left and right so well. It's just so difficult to predict. And here we see Dapper just not paying attention to where the positioning of the other team is, and unfortunately isn't able to make the right play. This game going so back and forth, and it seemed like Dapper and Garrett had control for the most part, but Enix coming out on top.
Oh, the turtle goal. Showing off there at the end. And it felt to me like Enix was basically playing the counterplay game, playing defense, waiting till both of the DAPG players committed, and then clearing it away and getting the goal on the other end. I felt like they spent very, very little time. I mean, you see 4 shots on Enix to 10 from DAPG. DAPG was up on offense so much more than Enix was, yet they were able to play efficiently. Great option there as they realized just wait till you have the easy shots.
Yeah, and there were just a few moments that I felt were a little bit fortunate for Enix, but they always position themselves to take advantage of the mistakes coming from DAPG, and that's huge, being able to recognize that there's a potential error that could happen here, and I need to position myself more aggressively if I want to be able to take advantage of it.
Now here, moving into Game 3, we're tied up at a game apiece. Enix going to try and upset the tournament favorites, DAPG. As they move this up the field, Dapper wraps that one around. And honestly, the big thing, other than playing the counterplay game, that Enix is doing well is leaving Sham in net. He has been a monster to deal with. So many beautiful plays set up by DAPG that are killed in the gateway by Sham.
Right, and we talk about 50-50s. It seems that for, honestly, a majority of the last game and this one as well, that we've seen DAPG struggle with the 50-50 game before easily clearing the ball from their own half. The transition from defense to offense, so seamless. Just
oh, man. Dapper just not able to get that one in. And can Gushwin get this one downfield in time? I believe Garrett G had the space, and Gushwin does not have the boost to move this one down. Yes, they won't get punished for that one again, but 2 players up on the backboard. They were not able to put it through. That's the sort of stuff that Enix was abusing all of Game 2. An open net here, though. Garrett G misses the open net. What, are you kidding?
I think that's a little, that's what we were all feeling or expecting. Garrett G, we see that crazy double touch and then missing the simple goals. I think after this way this last game went, that backflip, he's definitely feeling a little bit nervous. Now, no, he's on his last legs. There's a chance here he might not make it to the Universal Open Grand Finals.
They would have to lose 2 in a row here, but it could possibly happen. This one, again, as close as possible to scoring while still coming up with nothing. DAPG doing everything right to get the ball into the box, but just not able to put it through.
And good control from them as far as boost. We see them really limiting Enix when it comes to offensive opportunities. Oh, what a demo.
Can they get there? No, Garrett G's there to pinch it high, give Dapper time to respawn. And look at the respect from Enix, backing off, not wanting to overcommit, wanting to play their game, playing the counterplay game as long as it works. Sham drops this one through. And then there's Gushwind over the top, turning this challenging, and this leaves just Sham in the back. But he'll get it over the top of Dapper. The 50-50s that are being won here by Enix.
Oh, what a shot!
So many opportunities, but Sham again! Does not matter where DAPG shoots from, Sham slams the door on him.
And to give respect, that shot was from some distance, so it felt like...
Yeah, it was significantly a difficult read. But he did at least have the time to get up. Send that one away. Gushwin now trying to move this one out off the ceiling and the wall. Sham plays it away. Dapper, finally an opportunity. Sham's clear is ever so slightly not ideal, and Dapper punishes.
Buying just enough time for these guys to take a quick breather. Dapper with a great goal there, capitalizing on a missed clear. And that's something that we haven't seen at all in this game or in the last really defensive errors from Sham and Gushwind. All the goals that have been going on have been earned goals. Great offensive plays. We haven't seen many misforced errors, if any.
Garrett G now. Trying to send that one over the top. Gushwin's in the middle of the passing lane again. Taking advantage of the aggressive positioning from Dapper. But this time not able to sneak it underneath the crossbar. 2:03 left to go here. Garrett G moving this down the field. Holding on to the one goal. DAPG trying to take the lead again. And Dapper not able to get it out. Garrett was sitting right there in the box just waiting for the pass, but Dapper was unable to get it to cross the box. And now they have to fall back here. Sham inbound, plays it behind him, and wins the 50-50 with Gushwin. Sham needs to be moving back quickly as Garrett G is moving this one around in front of the net. Dapper to take the shot, and Sham gets there. It's always Sham who gets in the way.
I mean, just incredible reads, both on the offense and defense. Offense recognizing.
That was a scary one.
Alarm bells going off there.
Yeah, that was about to be the second own goal we'd seen from Garrett G. Third from Dap G in total. Dapper sent this one high, but Sham's still there to pressure Dapper. What positioning. Sham's shot goes right on top of him, and they will hold on to this clean sheet they've got. Garrett G to send it over the top of one, and now to come off the wall towards Geschwind. Slows it down, steals the boost. Trying to boost starve Enix in their own half. And time is on their side. They can just run this clock down. They will take the victory. Another shot. This one sneaks through as they had baited out Sham. Notice it was Geschwind in net this time instead of Sham.
I mean, regardless of who it was, what a shot with such precision there into that corner. It's so difficult to ever expect a shot like that because it's like, what? You really think you can score that?
It's so easy for it to hit the post instead and bounce out. The shooting more central is always a bit safer, but Garrett G able to put that one through. 2-0 now in favor of Dap G. And Garrett's going to look to see if he can make it three. Can he get another double tap? Getting one earlier in the series.
Oh, and a great demo there, buying so much space. Dapper, oh, gets it past him.
Sham will have to soft touch this one away. Not much he can really do here as Dapper gets it past him again, but Garrett G hanging in the back, not wanting to fall prey, realizing they do not need any more goals, does not want to fall prey to the breakaway. Just hold on the defense. Dapper will take the boost.
Oh,
fake one out.
Oh, so savage there from Dapper, just blowing the time, not letting Enix back into this game at all. I mean, well-executed game here from Dap G.
Yeah, they will take the victory here in Game 3, taking the lead again in our series. It's been back and forth between these guys. Dap G taking Game 1 and Enix taking Game 2, but now Game 3 back on the side of the favorites here, and they now have match point over Enix.
All right, so I got to ask you guys, the experts here, what accounts for Garrett G missing those open shots? You mentioned nerves before. Is there anything else that could be there? Unfamiliarity with the setting, I'm at a new land place. What accounts for that kind of stuff, those missed open goals?
I think the fact that he was so close to the ball, it's possible he didn't actually realize there wasn't a defender in net, and so he tries to take a more difficult shot towards the post, like we were talking about that last shot there at the end, instead of just taking the easy one right down the middle. Could have been something like that, or it could be the nerves.
Right, I mean, it is possible just to miss. It's just so uncharacteristic of Garrett G, who's considered by many to be one of the top two, three players in North America.
Okay, so we saw a little bit less of the pressure from Enix in that game. Dap G not making as many mistakes, doesn't have the opportunity for Enix to be able to come back in and capitalize on those. What was it, 4 shots to 5 shots right there? Mm-hmm. So a relatively low offense game. Is that what we're going to see for the rest of this series? Low offense, 2-0, 2-1 kind of games?
Well, the one thing I do like about this, about that stat line there is we saw 5 saves from Dap G. They had to play so much more defense than Enix side did, which means that the shots, the accuracy that was plaguing Enix in the beginning of the game is starting to wear off. They're starting to become more and more accurate, shooting better and better at the net. So it's becoming more and more their hands are full. I think the low scoreline is probably a thing that we're going to see more of, but at this time, I don't know. I'm glad to see the Rocket League has improved between these guys, both teams taking good shots.
Right, I'd have to agree, and I think we're about ready to get into our next match.
Game number 4. If Dap G takes the victory here, they move into the grand finals, qualifying for Santa Ana, California. And Dapper will play this one to the side. Right now, Enix with their backs against the wall. They have to win 2 straight against the favorites. Dapper moves this one up. Garrett G lurking in the midfield. I think he's in a low boost situation here. Dapper will play this one upfield. Take that midfield boost as well. Get a demo onto Geschwind. Good work here. On a day's work for Dapper.
And the spawn from Geschwind right in front of Garrett G. That was a huge opportunity for him to shoot. But as we mentioned before, when you get demolished, it's a 50-50 chance, completely random, whether you're going to spawn on the left side of the field or on the right side, and spawning right in front of the ball. How fortunate.
Works out for Enix here. They'll keep the score 0-0 in the first minute of Game 4. Sham. Try and play that one out. It's Geschwind in the back. He drops this one to the side, but Garrett and Dapper, well, a bit of confusion there on who was going to go for that one. Dapper is able to set it up on the crossbar, but it's very, very wide for Dapper to move across to try and finish anything off. Garrett will fall back as Geschwind moves this one up. Sham up on the wall, takes the clean shot towards the net. Garrett just gets there in time to clear it away. The epic save for the master player, and now they're looking for the transition counterattack.
Right. Such a good job from both teams. Both of them just honestly inches away from scoring, and we see really the nerves seem to have left both the teams. They're playing confidently, they're playing with intention. Sham and Geschwind, really their team play has elevated to a point where we see them putting great amounts of pressure on DapG. The pressure we haven't seen all tournament long.
Ooh, gutsy plays from Sham. Going for the back pass to nobody and then trying to wrap it around his own net. He's able to get away from Dapper though, and will stay scoreless as we move into the 3 minute area. Dapper up in the corner, falls back on the touches from Sham, played into the middle. Dapper's there as Garrett G was hanging back. And this one playing straight to Dapper into the box, but Sham will pick it up. Good positioning to know where that one would play off of Dapper's touch and not give them free shots. Garrett G in another opportunity here. Can't get there before Geschwind touches it off the wall. Now Geschwind looking for another one. Is Sham here too? The pressure coming through. Sham falls back. Great decision making, realizing that Garrett G would be there first, and plays it back away. And now another opportunity for Enix. Still scoreless as we cross halftime, Quinn.
I mean, what a match we have our hand. This game three really just the ultimate in terms of performance between both teams here. We see these team plays, this passing, great challenges. They're not giving each other any space, and that's what has led this game to be so close. Both of them trying to play great interference play, a lot of anticipation.
Now Garrett G. There's no way. Dapper lurks in the back. He's got the 1v2 to deal with. Sham makes use of Geschwind, takes the shot towards the neck, and Sham finish it off. No, it's back into the middle. A beautifully set up play, but that inaccuracy from game one comes back to haunt them. That's exactly what we've talked about so many times in the 1v2s. You saw Sham finally actually really make use of his teammate, and Dapper will get the play. Dunks it straight through him. Dapchi's got the lead.
Throughout the series, throughout the day, it's been a clinic on how to 1v1 from Dapper. He moves the ball forward onto the front of his car again for that 50-50 to just win it. It's just such a big difference when you approach a one-on-one situation, just trying to force 50-50s into favorable 50-50s by moving the ball in front of your car.
Dapper in the middle, alongside Sham. Takes it away from him, but the demo into Garrett G means Dapper has to buy time. That 50-50, one out by Geschwind. It just goes straight in as well. What? We have a tie game again.
Right here, that demolition, honestly, a very risky demolition, because if Geschwind doesn't make this touch and it happens to perfectly go in, if that did not happen, he would have been completely out of the game and it would have been a breakaway goal for DapG, but he took the risk and it paid off. And now we see with 1 minute and 20 seconds left, that's calculated.
And they have the tie game again. Their tournament lives on the line and they are surviving here. Sham nearly outpacing Dapper to get the lead back. But DapG wanting to be able to finish it here in four games. They don't want to see that game five. Bit of an overcommitment here as Dapper was unable to complete the shot. Now down the field, just Sham in the back. I don't think we've seen
it.
Oh my goodness, what a play. It's just been the Dapper show here. Two goals, 1v1 style in a row for Dapper.
We talk about the corner as one of the safest spots on the field, and Sham thought for sure there was no way Dapper was gonna be able to put that one on the net. But Dapper finds a way, what a play.
And now with 52 seconds left, the heat's turning up for Enix. They have to get the win in this game or they are done in the Universal Open. This isn't a good way to start out. Two players though committing there. If Sham can get this one away, Dapper, Garrett G just playing it back down and taking that one away after the double commitment, falling on it and buying ball control back in their favor. And then look at Garrett G versus Sham. Can he get the carry here over the top?
Oh.
It's just an outclassing in the 1v1 department right now.
Oh, take a look at this. He puts the ball on top of his car and turns himself underneath it and hits it with the double jump. Since he's turned his car behind him, he's able to lift his car up underneath the ball and get even more of an elevation on it, just beating the defender. And these are so creative. When you see a player go underneath the ball, jump and turn their car like that, what are you supposed to be thinking?
You're supposed to be thinking, man, I think we're about to lose to DapG. With 18 seconds left, down by two. It's all but done here for Enix as they are struggling to get out of their own half. The 1v1 skills come to play. And even as Sham dribbles this one down, can he get this one over? No, Dapper will play that one away. There was a hope and a sliver of a dream if that had gone in, but as the clock hits zero, Dap G does what we expected them to, qualifying for the finals here in Chicago and qualifying for the grand finals in Santa Ana.
You know, Wave Punk, I think you owe those guys an apology.
Oh, who? I motivated them.
Oh, what are you saying?
You heard him. They said, oh, I take that as a challenge.
Did you see that performance? That was incredible. Easily one of the best 2v2 performances against what we consider to be a number one seed across any of these regionals.
I absolutely agree.
No game was lost by more than two goals. They were competitive to the very end in every single one of the matches as well. I mean, so serious congratulations to Enix. And of course, our Lexus player of the match is going to be Dapper. So he secured it for himself, carrying his team to victory right there. And of course, an incredible performance. What'd you guys see from this guy?
I mean, it was just the 1v1 skills over and over again. Eliminate the first player and then let Dapper do his thing time and time again. He put those through. It was beautiful to watch.
Yeah, it's great, great play. I mean, across both of them, they knew that Dapper had those 1v1 abilities. Garrett G did, and he let Dapper shine. He played to the strengths of his teammate, and I think that's why they were so successful.
All right, well, we have our first team qualified for the grand final, so let's take a look at the updated Midwest Regional Bracket presented by American Sail. As we can see, Dap G advances past Enix 3-1, actually winning that last game 3-1 as well, and they're waiting on the winners of Splice versus Runaway to see who is going to get that seeding for the grand finals in Santa Ana. But right now, with our winners in Dap G, we've got Michael Jenkins. Take it away.
Couple of individual questions for you guys. You know, early on in this series, there was a couple of questions about you missing open shots, and then you make one like that to clinch it.
Yeah, you know, to be quite honest, I'm happy we made it to California, but, you know, I'm really frustrated with how I've showed up today because, you know, I'm hitting some good shots, but, you know, those simple, easy shots that, you know, I should hit every day, I'm missing. So I'm definitely going to be thinking about that a lot.
Dapper, that second goal in the final game was particularly impressive from that angle. How much has your 1v1 experience really helped you here?
A lot. Two is you get a lot more space to do things like that, so I try to take advantage of it the most I can.
Well, most importantly, you're headed to the grand finals. Congratulations. Gentlemen, back to you.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, one grand final spot remains. Will it be Splice or Runaway that moves one step closer to the $100,000 prize pool? Find out next right here on CSN Chicago.